Hello, the topic for today's discussion is heuristic based query optimization, which is coming under module 5 CS208 principles of database design. So before directly, actually heuristic based query optimization is a query optimization strategy, is one of the query optimization strategy. So before directly going to heuristic based query optimization, we'll just see what is query optimization as such. Query optimization. Query, as we all know, it is just an instructions to the database. It's an instruction in any high-level language to the database. Then what is optimization? Optimization, the word meaning is, to, what do you mean? Optimization is just like to execute something or utilize the resource in the best effective way. So query optimization is actually a query may have many possible execution strategies, and our aim is to identify the best possible optimization strategy, best possible way of executing the query. Optimization, as I already told, it is the effective way of utilizing the resource. Here, we are talking about a computer. What will be the effective way of utilizing a resource? It can be effective utilization of memory, effective utilization of the processing power. So query optimization, we are trying to find the most effective way to execute the query such that the memory consumption is minimum as well as the computational power taken is minimum. So as the definition say, a query typically has many possible execution strategy, and the process of choosing the best suitable one, for processing a query is known as query optimization. The topic is actually not only in the point of exam, not only exam point of view, the topic is relevant in an industrial perspective also. So once we explain the concept, you'll understand the relevance of this topic. So other than directly explaining query optimization, I have to explain the steps in processing a high-level query. Then only you will be understanding the significance of query optimizer and the place where in the processing this particular step comes. So we'll start from the high-level language query which needs to be optimized. So I'm telling once more, like, optimization is a process of executing the query in the best possible way so that the memory consumption is minimum as well as the computational power taken is minimum. So given a high-level language query, our aim is to optimize it. So I'm just explaining the various steps coming in the process of processing a high-level language query. So given a query, these are the different steps the query should go through. So query in the high level language will be given as the input. The first step is scanning. Scanning is nothing but we are checking for the keywords, whether there is any spelling mistake or the, we are tokenizing and checking for the syntax of each token, whether it is correct or not. Next step is parsing. Parsing check for the grammatical errors. Like we know in the case of SQL, select star from table name. This from should be followed, select should be followed by the keyword from. So that grammar, which should be followed by what, that grammar will be checked in the parsing step. So scanning checks for the keywords, parsing checks for the validity of the syntax. Next, after the scanning and parsing, a validation of the query, whether the query is valid, will be confirmed and it is given to the query optimizer. Here comes our query optimizer. So the input of the query optimizer is an intermediate form of a query. So this intermediate form of the query will be generated after a proper scanning, parsing and validation. So this intermediate form of the query will be the input of our query optimizer, which has to be optimized. So generating this intermediate form of the query, actually this intermediate form of the query, we can have two intermediate forms. One is query tree and the other is query graph. We learn how to generate a query tree or a query graph from a given high-level language query. That we'll see, but I'll just explain the steps as such. So this intermediate form of the query, which is a query tree or a query graph, will be the input to a query optimizer. The query optimizer will generate the most optimized way how to execute a query. This execution plan, this query optimizer will generate the optimized query, and this optimized query will be given to a code generator which generate the corresponding code, and it is given to the runtime database processor which processes the query and gives the output to the user. Okay, so these are the different steps. As I told you, the topic is not only relevant in the exam point of view, but also it is relevant in the industrial perspective. Why? Because most of the industry are considering the optimized version of the query as the input to their processor. If the as a programmer, if you are doing some query and if you are giving us the giving it for processing, most of the industries won't accept, most of the industrial processors won't accept a non-optimized query. So a query has to be optimized properly before giving to a processor. So that is why this concept is very relevant in an industrial perspective also. Because only, you know, majority of the companies, the processor will accept only the optimized version of the query because they don't want to waste their memory, they don't want to waste their processing capacity. So that is the relevance of the topic here. Okay, so these are the general steps. The input high-level language query will be given for scanning, passing, and validation. And an intermediate form of a query will be generated, which is a query graph or a query tree, and will be given to the query optimizer, which generates the optimized version of the query. So here is our query optimizer. So these are the general steps in processing a high-level language query. So this query optimization strategies, we have two query optimization strategies. The first is cost-based query optimization and the second is heuristic-based query optimization. As per our syllabus, we have to learn cost-based query optimization, so that will be explained in detail. So first we'll just see what is cost-based query optimization. As I told you, all the queries will be having a set of possible execution strategy. Cost-based query optimization typically estimates the cost of all the execution strategies. It will compute the cost of all the different possible execution strategies and it will find which is the best one, which is the best optimized one. It will execute all the strategies, all the possible strategies for executing a query. Like, for example, if you have two tables, we can, if you have three tables, you can join the first two tables first, then we can go and join the second two tables. Other than that, you can join the first and third table. So the cost-based query optimization will consider the joining operation of all the possible tables and it will find the best one. So the problem is like, the advantage is like this will be the perfect one because it is trying out every possible execution strategy and coming up with the best one. But the problem is like, it is much time consuming, but because as we all know, it is trying out every possible execution strategy, so that much time will be consumed. So the advantage is that this will be the optimum one, the disadvantage is like it will consume much time. So this is the cost base, it will try out every possible execution strategies, and our topic for discussion is heuristic based query optimization. It is the second strategy of optimizing a query. Heuristic, as the name implies, it requires some level of intelligence. Okay, we are applying some intelligent thoughts over the query. We are not going to execute or try out every possible strategies. We are not going to look into every possible strategies. We are trying to apply some intelligence so that we can find out the best possible one. But I'll tell you, like, this heuristic query optimization doesn't always promise to give the best one. Because we are applying some intelligence, we are trying out to find this heuristic techniques will, majority of the cases, it will work well. But in some cases, it might fail because it is not, we are not trying out all the possible strategies. We are applying some level of intelligence over the query to find the best possible execution strategy for a given query. So either we are using a cost-based optimization or we are going for a heuristic-based query optimization, the first step is to translate the given high-level language query. As I told you, the input to the query optimizer will be an intermediate form of the query, but as a first step, we'll be getting a query which is written in a high-level language. Query which is written in a high-level language, as per your syllabus, you're most familiar with SQL, which is structured query language. So given a structured, given a query which is written in a high-level language, that is SQL, will be your input. So from this query, you have to generate a relational algebra query corresponding to the given SQL query. Okay, that is the first step. Given a high-level language query, you have to generate a relational algebra query out of the high-level language query. That is translating SQL query to relational algebra. How will you do that? We have a sample query here, select p dot p number, comma p dot d num, comma e dot l name, e dot address, e dot b date from project as p. As we all know, P is the aliasing or the duplicate name given for the table project, relation project. As like, just like that, D is the aliasing given for department, E is the aliasing given for employee, and the conditions are given over here. This condition P dot denum indicates that denum is a member of the relational, is member of the relation project. Likewise, D dot denumper indicate that denumper is a member of the relation department. So this is a high level language query. How will you convert it to a relational algebra query? It's very simple. We all know, like, the select operation for a high level language query correspond to the project operation of a relational algebra query. So here we need to select P number, D num, L name, address and B date. So the corresponding project operation will project these values, sorry, these attributes. So project followed by whatever has to be selected, project followed by those values has to be written. Then this this condition comes here as a select operation. This P location is equal to Stafford has to be retrieved from the project relation, so it has to be given accordingly. And in our query, we are having project, department and employee, and we need to retrieve the values from these three tables, so we know we have to join these three tables based upon this condition. Okay, so this is how you convert a high-level language query to a relational algebra query. So this is the first step. For any query optimization process, this is the first step you have to do. So as I told you, the input to a query optimizer is an intermediate representation of a query. It can be either a query tree or it can be either a query graph. So now we'll learn how to generate a query tree. Query tree is more beneficial compared to a query graph, so normally we'll go for generating a query tree as an intermediate representation. So we'll see how to generate a query tree. It's very simple. See, the project operation where the value, we'll see like this, leaves of the tree. This is a query tree, is nothing but a tree structural representation of the query. So the leaves of the tree corresponds to the relations in the given SQL query. The leaves corresponds to the relation. In the case, we have three relations, right? Project, department and employee. So these three comes as the leaves. The aliasing name will be written in circles as nodes. Okay, then what operation you have to perform on this particular relation will come as the relation algebra internal nodes. As I told you, leaves are the relations, this internal nodes corresponds to the operation. So this is how you create a query tree. Root of the query tree corresponds to the value we need to project, and the conditions will be appropriate. Like, see, from the project table, what you have to select? You have to select P dot P location is equal to Stafford. This particular thing has to be selected from the project table, and from this department, after joining these two, we'll go to the further step, because to get denum, denum belongs to project table and denumber belongs to department table. So to satisfy or to check for this condition, you need to join these two. Okay, so accordingly you have to create the query tree. So query tree is an intermediate representation which will be given as the input to a query optimizer. Clear? Understood how to generate a query tree? The leaves will be the relations, the nodes will be the operations performed on this, operations to be performed on this relation. So this is a sample query tree. And we have, as I told you, canonical representation. Canonical representation you have to make out of this query tree. This canonical representation is actually the input to the query optimizer. So once after generating this query tree, you have to generate the canonical representation of the query tree. It is nothing but we are just uplifting these operations to the top. Okay, this will remain as such. This P number, this project operation, everything will remain as such. Only thing is that this the operation coming in the corresponding internal nodes will be uplifted. So this is the thing. So you know here you are performing a join operation, so that symbol will remain here. And the values written over here will be just uplifted to a much higher level. So this is the canonical representation corresponds to the initial query tree which we have generated. This canonical representation will be our input to the query optimizer. Okay. So as I told you, we have one more intermediate representation. It's a query graph. Query graph is nothing but we have relations. We have circles denoting the relations. We have three aliasing names, P, D, and E. So it is denoted by circles. And the condition which joins these two relations will be written over the edges. Here, P dot denum equal to D dot numper. That condition will be given over the edges. And the values which should be selected from the table P will be written in a square bracket. From the table P, we know we have to retrieve P number and D num. So these two values has to be written inside a square bracket. And constant in our query, we have a single constant, that is P location is equal to Stafford. It is a constant. We are searching for a constant value. This constant should be written inside this double ovals. So this is how we create a query graph. Query graph is least common considered to a query tree because query graph doesn't show the order of execution. Query graph doesn't show the order of execution. So normally we'll go for query tree. So now we'll particularly see what is heuristic optimization, because as per your syllabus, heuristic optimization is coming. So this one I'll be explaining in detail. Heuristic query optimization, as I told you, we'll be applying some level of intelligence over the query. So one of the main heuristic rule is to apply select and project operation before the join operation. As I told you, optimization is nothing but we are trying to reduce the memory consumption. We are trying to minimize the utilization of memory space, as well as we are trying to reduce the computational capacity. Okay, so we are trying to optimize the query in terms of minimizing the memory and minimizing the computational power. So what can we do for that? First thing, we are trying to apply select and project operation before join. If you are simply joining two tables without any condition, what will happen? We are simply joining two tables. That much value will be projected to the higher level. Simply joining two tables means if you are simply performing some Cartesian product, what will happen? Two tables will be joined as such. We are not talking about a table which is having five tuples, a table which is having two, three attributes. We are talking about huge tables. Huge relations. In that case, what will happen? If you are not checking for any condition, if you are simply joining two tables, that much value will be, that much attributes and that much tuples will be forwarded to the much higher level. So what we are trying to do, we are doing this select and project operation much earlier, so that only the minimum values which is required in the higher level need to be selected. We don't have to move all those tuples as well as attributes to the higher level. We are just applying a condition. Based upon the condition, whatever is the necessary ones, only those tuples and attributes we need to move to a higher level. We don't have to take all to the higher level, which will consume much memory and much computational power. So applying this select and project operation before join operation, that will reduce the memory consumption as well as reduce the computational power needed. Okay, so this is the intelligence, or this is the heuristics we are applying here. So is to apply select and project operation before performing a join operation. So select the tuples needed, and projects or retrieves the attributes needed. So we are not moving entire thing to the higher level. So that is the intelligence we are applying here. Then optimizer must include some rules of heuristic. It has to do some reordering mechanism to generate the final optimized version of the query. So these are the five steps in converting a query tree using heuristic optimization. These are the five steps coming in a heuristic based query optimization. As I told you, the input to a heuristic based query optimizer will be the canonical query tree. We learned how to generate a query tree. We learned how to create a canonical representation out of this query tree. So this canonical representation of the query tree will be the input to a query optimizer in the case of a heuristic optimization. We are talking about heuristic optimization. The heuristic optimization is having five steps. We are seeing one by one here. So input will be the canonical version of the query tree. From a given query, you know how to create the canonical version, right? you know how to create. We have already seen that. Next step is moving the select operation down the tree. That is, we are moving the select operation down the tree means we are optimizing to that level. We are moving the select operation down means we are doing the select operation much earlier, which will consume, which will reduce the memory consumption. Then applying the more restrictive select operation. What do you mean by more restrictive select operation? Or what is the difference between a normal select operation and a more restrictive select operation? More restrictive select operation is the one in which retrieves the minimum number of tuples. Which retrieves the minimum number of tuples. That is a more restrictive one. So from a given query, identify which is the more restrictive one, move that first. Or move that to the bottom. I'll show you, we'll see a detailed example here. I'll just explain the steps 4 and 5 also. Replacing the Cartesian product. So after moving the more restrictive select operation down the query tree, the next step is replacing Cartesian product and select with join operation. What is the advantage here? We know the difference between Cartesian product and a join operation. Cartesian product does what? It will simply join two tables. And what the join operation does? Join operation joins two tables based upon a condition, which is more efficient. Obviously, join operation is more efficient because it consumes, it is checking a condition and the tuples which satisfy that particular condition will be the result. So we are replacing all the Cartesian product and select with join operation. So select gives the condition for join operation. So we are replacing all the Cartesian product and select with the corresponding join operation. And the last step is moving project operation down the query tree. We are moving the project operation. Till now we talked about select operation. Now we are moving the project operation down the query tree. That will also select the attributes which are particularly needed. We don't need all the tuples. We don't need all the attributes. This moving the project attribute down, moving the project operation down the query tree means we are trying to minimize the number of attributes coming to the higher level. So these are the 5 steps which has to be done for heuristic query optimization. We'll see an example. So this is find the last name of employee born after 1957 who worked on a project named Aquarius, where L name, SSN and B date belongs to the table. Employee P name, P number belongs to the table project, and PNO belongs to the table works on. So this is the question given. Sometimes you'll be getting a high level language query, sometimes you'll be getting a question like this, from which you have to generate the high level language query, or you can directly go for relational algebra expression. So this is the high level language query corresponding to the question given. We know P name belongs to, P name and P number belongs to project, and PNO belongs to works on. L name, SSN and B date belongs to the table employee. So what is the first step? You have to generate the canonical representation out of this high level language query. You know how to generate a query tree, right? So all these employee works on project will come as the leaves, the corresponding operation will come as the internal nodes. And how about this constant? Which is the, yeah, we'll see. So you know how to generate a query tree, you know how to generate the canonical representation out of this query tree, right? All these values condition has to be uplifted, and this is the canonical representation correspond to the SQL query given. This is a canonical representation. We know we have employee works on and project table. These are the conditions followed by select operation. And we have to project one and only one value, which is the L name. That comes as the root of the query tree. So this is a canonical representation of the query tree. And what is the next step? What do you have to do? As a next step, you have to move the select operation down the query tree. We have these many select operations. You have to move the select operations to the appropriate table. You know this B date. B date belongs to employee. So move from this set, move the B date to the employee. From this set, move P name to Aquarius. Okay, so from this set, you have to do the appropriate splitting. You have to move the select operation down the query tree. And what is the next step? So you have done the appropriate movement. And what is the next step? From this, you have to identify the most restrictive select operation. As I told you, the most restrictive select operation is the select operation which retrieves the minimum number of tuples. Which is the minimum? We'll check the first case. B date greater than 1957 or this particular date. We'll get a set of tuples satisfying this condition, right? We'll get a set of persons who have born, whose birth date will be greater than this particular value. Obviously, we'll get a set of values. And how about the this thing? P name is equal to acquirer's. It is more specific, right? It is more specific. It is particularly checking whether the P name is equal to acquirer's. So compared to B date, normally this P name is equal to acquirer's will be the most selective one, right? Normally. That is why I am saying this heuristic query optimization won't work in all cases, because if sometimes this B date greater than this particular, if the table doesn't have any such tuples satisfying the condition, obviously this will be the better one, right? This will be the more selective one. But normally we'll select this one, because P name is equal to acquirer's. Normally we are checking for a constant, means that will be the most selective one. So in the case we'll check for a if there is a constant like this, we'll identify that as the most selective, most restrictive select operation. So the as a third step, we'll move this more restrictive select operation down the query tree. And one thing you have to keep in mind is, like, when we move the more restrictive select operation down the query tree, the tree will be shifted accordingly, right? If simply we cannot place this project over here and remaining things let it be as such, you cannot transform like project comes here, employee goes there. We cannot tell like that. You have to apply the intelligence. You have to check whether the higher level conditions are getting satisfied. If you are moving project here from project and work zone, can we derive this condition? If not, you have to move the corresponding relations accordingly. You have to rearrange the tree accordingly. After doing each step, you have to reorder or rearrange the tree appropriately. And so now we did, right? We moved the most restrictive select operation down the query tree. So that step is over. This is our third step. And next, what you have to do? You have to move the project operation down the query tree, right? You have to move. So from this, what you have to retrieve, that particular value has to be projected. So see, from here, before that you have to do one more thing. You have to replace all the Cartesian product with the join operation. As I told you, Cartesian product consumes more memory. This Cartesian product has to be replaced using a join operation. So this join operation will replace all the Cartesian products over here. That is step 4. And step 5, as I told you, you have to move the project operation down the query tree. So see, from here, you know P number, only the value P number is needed in the much higher level. So you don't have to take everything. You have to just pick the P number, project the P number which is needed in the higher level. So pick that. So move the project operation down the query tree. So from the higher level, we are moving the project operation. Which are the attributes needed? We need to identify those attributes, and those attributes has to be picked. From each level, you have to do like that. So only the necessary attributes will come to the higher level. That way we can optimize the query. So we have seen the 5 steps for the query optimization. First is creating the canonical representation from the given SQL, given higher level language query. Then you have to, which are the steps? This is a canonical representation. You have to move the select operation down the query tree. You have to identify the most restrictive select operation and make that as the bottom one. And next step, you have to replace all the Cartesian product with the join operation. And as the last step, you have to move the project operation down the query tree. So these are the 5 steps of a query optimization. So we'll see the summary. The main heuristics, the main intelligence we are applying here is we are trying to minimize the intermediate result as much as we are trying to reduce the result as much as possible. So that is the intelligence we are applying here. The main heuristic is to apply the first operations that reduce the size of intermediate results. We are trying to reduce the size of intermediate results. That is the heuristic we are applying here. So for that, you have to perform select operations as early as possible. You have to do the project operation as early as possible, and you have to replace Cartesian product with join operation. And finally, the main thing you have to identify is that you have to do a reordering, because we are modifying this. We are simply selecting a project from here, a select from here. We are moving that relation to this side. So we cannot simply do that. You need a careful reordering of the tree. That is mandatory. There we need to apply some intelligence. So this is all about heuristic query optimization. Thank you for listening.